Today we are going to talk about process after prayer, or I can say that pattern, finding out what pattern you must have after you go to pray. Now, we all know we pray. We learned about communication, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. We don't wait for God's voice to come. We just pray a prayer and close it. We just don't want to talk anything more. But according to me, prayer is something talking, our Father, and then he talks to you. Hi, my son, how are you? What can I do for you? Right? What can I do for you? Sometimes he will talk to you so beautifully. I've experienced over these years, and I was talking to Susan yesterday, the best thing that I enjoyed in my Christian life is talking to God and hearing from him. And so wonderful. He has talked to you certain things that you will never ever hear from any of the Christian messages that you hear on YouTube or at churches. The Holy Spirit gives you one word, and that word is more than enough for you. Hallelujah. More than enough. So today, the prayer should lead you to find the pattern. Can we all remember this today? Prayer should lead you to find the pattern. And the pattern is to find the solution. You got it? You must know what is the pattern that you should follow to find the solution in your own personal life. Facing your giant means there is a giant that is in front of you. Whatever it is. Like you said, you were feeling the loneliness or discouragement. You were looking at the Facebook pictures of your friends and suddenly you felt, Amma, Appa, where are you? Oh, I'm missing you all. You know, so many days I have not been able to. But that discouragement is so much. Immediately we think of quitting from or going back and getting into the old life. Whereas God tells you and me, pray with God, communicate to God and find out how can I find encouragement in discouragement. Amen. Do you know something? The biggest discouragement that anybody can imagine, think about Joshua's story. Joshua found his biggest leader, the biggest, you know, the best friend of Joshua was Moses, because all the time he was talking to Joshua, Moses, and you know, he was able to see the leadership of Moses, and beautifully he led everyone. But all of a sudden, Joshua chapter 1, Moses, my servant, is dead. Times of India, whichever newspaper, Moses is dead. Now, the new leader, Joshua, I want you to go and fight the battle. It's not easy. First of all, the grievance of losing your friend, or grievance of losing your leader, and also the challenge of facing the leadership and the kinds of people who you are going to deal with, because he has already seen how the people are. They always want to go back. Right? When you look at the chapter 1 of Joshua, you will find one thing that God spoke before anything. He said, be strong. Be strong. How many times do you know? 4 to 5 times God spoke in the chapter 1. Be strong and then courageous. You need the strength, you need the courage. Why? Because you are discouraged and you need encouragement. When you feel your leader is dead and you don't have any inspiration or someone to who you can talk to, and here comes Joshua, don't worry, be strong, I am your strength. Hallelujah. When he is your strength, no matter what, I will tell you, in your life, not your parents, not even your spouse, not even your children will ever remain with you all the time. One person remains very often and common in your life from the time you are born. Who is that? God. Amen. That's why Jeremiah, when he was in the chapter 1, God told Jeremiah, don't say you're only a child. I knew you before you were formed in the mother's womb. Hallelujah. Isn't it wonderful that God knows us? So prayer should lead us to find the pattern, that is the process that we need in our life. When we want to go through something, we are praying and we ask God, what can I do right now? Amen. What can I do? The biggest important thing at that moment is waiting for the instruction from God. Are you able to understand? waiting for the instruction from God, because prayer has to be followed with the word and also the instruction from the Lord. If that is not, then it is just a talking. Many people just say, amen, go back. Some people comb the hair and say, our Father, what in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, comb your hair, put your powder, put your cream, whatever it is. That's not prayer. That's not prayer. Prayer is listening from God more than you talking, because you're carrying a message for your day. Give us this day my daily bread. Hallelujah. Why? Why do you need an instruction from God? Do you know why? Because you're not fighting against flesh and blood, but against the principalities of the air. And that is what Paul mentioned in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 11. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against the flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand. Amen. Withstand in the evil day. Hallelujah. Withstand in the evil day is the day when you find you cannot handle it by yourself. Amen. On that day when you feel all your strength is gone. Amen. All your hope is gone. And you might sing a song. I have the strength. Strength within the sorrow. We can sing. But that time, it's not just singing alone. It's believing what you are singing. I know one girl, you know, who was a medical doctor. She had a problem. She completed a medical degree in Muscat. And she was not getting a job. Because as per the law of Oman, you have to complete 3 years work experience to get a medical doctor's job. And here this girl is a worship leader. And that day she came to pray and said, Uncle, I want you to pray. I said, okay. I asked her the question. She sang a song. God will make a way where there seems to be no way. Good song. Wonderful song. She sang the song. She came, sat in front of me. And then I asked her one question. I asked her, I just saw you singing, God will make a way where there seems to be no way. Do you believe that? She said, Uncle, seriously? No. I don't believe. I don't believe. I told her, you believe. God will make a way when there seems to be no way. Hallelujah. I prophesied to her sitting on the chair. That time I said, God will make a way when there seems to be no way. Amen. He will make a way for you no matter what you are going through. How terrible the situation is. Within a month and a half, this girl, her name is Prabha, she got the job as a medical doctor in Royal Hospital in Muscat. And she's still working in the hospital. I'm talking about more than 14 years, approximately 10, 14 years. What I'm trying to say is, when you get the word from the Lord, you need to believe that it is my God who spoke. It is not the government who spoke to me. Hallelujah. It's not the government who spoke, but it is God who spoke. When He tells you something, it will come to pass. If anybody else has told you, it will not happen, maybe. My point is, when you hear somebody prophesying, ask the Lord, are you talking to me? Because God will confirm to you directly. Wait for God's instruction. Don't just immigrate to Canada or Australia because somebody else prophesied, but immigrate to Canada because God spoke to you. Amen. You understand? Like, you take the story of Kings, Apostle Paul. When he met Jesus, he was in the house. Who heard apart from Paul? Ananias. Did anyone go and tell Ananias? My point is, even the street was mentioned. The road was mentioned by God to this man. He gives you the address. Hallelujah. So wait for His instruction. Don't find shortcut in your life when you want to make decision. Wait for him to tell you. Now let me come back to this message here. So when you are standing to pray, take the instruction from God. Now Paul mentioned how many armors are there in the Bible in Ephesians chapter 6. Okay, let me tell you, there are 7 actually, including the prayer. Okay, I will tell you why. Because when you look at the Bible, first of all is, it is belt of truth. Correct? Then breastplate of righteousness. Then gospel of peace. That is your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. And then shield of faith. Right? And then helmet of salvation. Sword of the spirit. And pray in the spirit. Amen? Prayer in the spirit. Praying in the spirit is the most important thing. You must be praying always, Bible says. When you put on this armor that God is giving it to you, you must put on the full armor of God and also pray continually. Pray at all times. Pray without ceasing. When you keep praying, what happens? Let's say, when you are praying, what happens is something will happen in your life. What someone said, prayer doesn't change God. Then what changes? Prayer changes you. Prayer changes your mindset. Prayer changes your desire. When you keep praying, when you keep asking God, we say ask and it shall be given, right? And seek and you shall find, and knock and the door shall be opened. But actually ask is asking what God your will is, not my will. The same way we need to understand, it's not what you want, it's what he wants to give you. Amen. You need to identify the will of God and the plan of God when you are facing the giant. Let me take you to the scriptures. Let's turn to 1 Kings chapter 17. Elijah comes in. Introduction here in the verse 1. As the Lord God of Israel lives, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years except at my word. He said that. After he said that, what was the immediate response of God? He said something that there shall be no rain except at my word. What was the... See, there is a word from the Lord. Hallelujah. The Bible says the word of the Lord came to Elijah in verse 2. Word of the Lord came to Elijah the first time. What was the instruction coming? What was the instruction in verse 2? Verse 3. Yeah. Get away. God gives you instruction. Get away sometimes. Without an exodus, there cannot be a revelation. We want revelation without an exodus. Sometimes we must be willing to go into an exodus in a hideout where we get into the presence of God and learn what God wants to talk to you. Got it? So get away from here and turn eastward and hide. We sing, hide me now. Isn't it? Under your wings, cover me. That's the time when God covers you. Amen. But you have to hide. Hiding in his presence is very, very important. Why you're hiding? When do you hide? Tell me. When do you hide? Why do you hide? Tell me. You hide because you don't want the other person to be seen. Or you don't want to see the other person, right? Mostly we play that hide and seek. God says, from King Ahab, I want you to hide. Right? But during the time when you're hiding, I'm actually doing something in your life. Amen? Isn't it wonderful? We don't want to go into a hideout. We don't want to go into a quietness, remoteness, where only you and me. Let me ask you one question. Very simple. Don't answer. When is the last time that you have gone to a place, solitary place, all alone? I'm not talking about any friend with you. I'm talking all alone by yourself. beside your cell phone, nothing along with you, no laptop with you, no cell phone with you, no friend with you, no network, no data, nothing. When is the last time you have gone? Which year did you go? When you are waiting upon God, He will know that you are interested to listen to God. Amen. Without that, He will not do anything. So get away. So here we know that Elijah was in the hideout and, you know, he got the ravens and the food and everything. But during that time, God was actually building the life of Elijah. Are you getting? God was building the life of Elijah. When you pray, you sometimes think that nothing is happening. I have prayed for 8 hours in a day in tongues. I've spent time, but I want to tell you, I have not seen mountains moving that time. Seriously, I have not seen many things happening. I went through financial crisis, lots of troubles in my life. But I kept on praying. That 1 Corinthians chapter 14 says, when you pray in tongues, what happens? You know that? What happens when you pray in tongues? Is there anybody who can tell when you pray in tongues, what happens? You are edifying yourself. What is edifying? What is building? Puffing you. Becoming a Superman in spirit. Are you getting? Even a man like Joshin, who is very slim, will look very strong when you are puffed in the spirit. Amen. He will be walking like this, so strong. I am. You know what? That faith, when you pray in the spirit, in the presence of God, that time you are actually building a faith in God, understanding of who God is. You worship and you adore God. You hear Him. You cry in His presence. You talk to Him. You fight with Him. You do everything. But you are actually getting to know this God. And that builds. You know what we normally do is, we want a solution to the problem, but we don't understand the solution is not anything for God. God is looking for you more than anything. God is looking for your time. I know a person, Brother Dinakaran mentioned in one of his messages years before. He mentioned there was a man who used to go from the mill at 5 o'clock. The mill gets over. He was working in a mill. At 5 o'clock, he goes to the church, sits in the church, just talk nothing to God, just sit that way. Every day at 5 o'clock, he was there. One day something happened. He met with an accident and he was in the hospital. And the story says, his name is Jim in the story. Jim was lying down on the bed. Here comes Jesus. Jesus says, my son, all these days you came at 5 o'clock. Today I know you couldn't come. So I have come to you. Hallelujah. I have come to you. That is prayer. For not receiving, did Jim receive anything? No, that day no. He felt anything? No, but his habit was praying with God every day. Every time he was communicating to God and he was doing everything. And that was the major reason one day he could get that feedback from God. Jim, you couldn't come today and I have come to say hello to you. Amen. Isn't it wonderful? So here is it. When you pray, what happens? Elijah was in that prayer in the brookside with the ravens coming. He was worshiping God, praying. And then, like the earlier, the same chapter 17 in verse 1, he stood in front of Ahab. And the second verse says, the word of the Lord came to Elijah. And go, here comes again. Next thing is the word of the Lord in verse 8. What is that? First instruction was, what was the first instruction? Get away. Second one is not get away. Arise. Do you know something? Arise is different. We always want to rise up when we want to. I remember this week, some people were sharing on Cornerstone group about the preaching part and all, the young kids preaching and all. I was telling that we mostly rise up before we are raised. No, don't do that. We'll fall. Even a kid takes time to walk.
Let the kid grow up slowly. I understand and I respect the Holy Spirit, but let the child grow up, study the Bible and read the Bible with the parents, sit and pray and understand who God is, and then he can come and preach. It's so different. So my point is, the first one is get away. The second instruction is, Elijah, you don't have to hide now. You've done enough, you've prayed enough, and you've done enough. Now I want you to go, arise, go to the widow's house, right? So the instruction is very important. Why I'm bringing this is, when you're facing your giant, the most important thing is you need to get the instruction from God to fight. Otherwise, the giant will kill you. Are you able to understand? We do the fight on our own. Show me one place where the healing took place in the gospel without one word. The Lord was moved with the compassion. The Lord was moved with the compassion. And that compassion that came from the Father in heaven upon Jesus moved Jesus when he saw the people sick. He saw the multitude hungry. That compassion of God moved. It's not Jesus. Hallelujah. Are you getting something? When you try to do it on your own strength, you will fail miserably. But when you take the strength of God, when you are in prayer, you are pumping yourself, puffing yourself, you are doing things, praying in tongues, whichever way, praying in the spirit, you're getting stronger, you're edifying, you're building, you're getting that muscles are building, your spiritual muscles. Amen. And then you stand up. What you say is with power. Are you able to understand? It is with power, not your power. I was just thinking about a song. Not by mine, but by my spirit, says the Lord, not by power, but in my strength you shall go forth. Victory is yours before the battle begins. Not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord. Isn't it wonderful? Not by anything, but by his spirit, says the Lord. Amen. You don't fight the battle by your strength, but his strength. And that can only be derived when you go into the prayer room, into the upper room with God and start listening to him and getting that power and go. Amen. Elijah was getting the word. I'll tell you, the word from the Lord is very powerful. Jesus was walking on the water and Peter saw him at a distance. What was Peter telling? Do you remember what did Peter tell Jesus? At your word, are you getting? At your word, I am willing to walk on the water. At your word, in at your word, I know the world was created. At your word, Lazarus came out of the tomb. At your word, I want that word. I don't want to do it my way, but I want to do it in your way. And that word you can only get because the Bible says he ordains what? Your steps. That means 1, 2, 3. Every step of yours is ordained and commanded by God. And when you are in prayer, when you are immersed in prayer, when you're praying to God every time, remember one thing. I was just visualizing this way. You know, when you're surrounded by giants, problems around. And when you are dwelling in the shelter of the Most High, when you're praying with God, when you're in the spirit, you know what I'm trying to tell you? In that spirit, Bible says, you know, that, but you know, there are people saying in the night, the satanic forces, they appoint their angels concerning you to attack you. So here is Satan. Thomas is going today. I want you to come on. This person, that person, all the person in his team, go and find out how we can put him in trouble. Yeah. So here is a plan to attack Thomas. And what happens on the other side? In the night, this dark forces start preparing his plan. And you're getting up in the morning
and you're going into the spirit. And you start praying, you know, and that time what happens is the demons are all operating all around you and they are trying to attack you, and all of a sudden Joshua come first. And here is Joshua, here is all around him the demons. Okay, all around him the demons. And here is Joshua who is praying, and in the spirit of God, what happens is, God will tell, Sam come here. Here is God's angels and here is the demon all around Joshua. And here Sam is commanded. God tells Sam, you are the angel of God, right? And God tells all the angels, go and cover him. Amen. Go and cover him. Are you getting? Go and cover him. Can I touch him? No, I cannot. What will happen? You will try to fight with me, right? You'll try to fight with me. Thank you. What I want to tell you is, when you are in prayer, God commands his angels concerning you. He will say, go and protect this guy. He's my son. He's my child. I don't want him to be harmed today. So when you drive, when you are doing anything, when you're going for the interview, you know, I know years before when Susan went for the interview, I saw in the newspaper, I saw the advertisement, I heard from God, this is the job Susan is going to get. I saw Susan went for the interview, came out, and you've seen Susan, right? Enough, all of you. I've never seen Susan excited in my life, except that day. She came after the interview and she was telling, you know what, I don't know what happened. And she was walking, because we didn't have the car. She was walking and she was telling, you know what, I don't know what, all questions, any question they ask, I was able to answer. I don't know, even before, I don't know how I could answer. I said, yeah, because there was a man sitting outside in 90s. Sitting outside and praying for her, interceding for her, and God gave her the job. Amen. Are you getting that? My point is, when you want to fight with your giant, you have to make sure you cannot win the battle, but you have to win the battle by your prayer life. By your prayer life. Activate your prayer life. Activate your relationship with God. See, we know the story. He went to widow's place because he heard from God. He was so confident. You know, he made a statement there in the same chapter. What's the punch word in this verse? What is the punch word? Can anybody get? Punch word. Key thing in this verse. Thus says the Lord God of Israel. Thus says, at his word. How could this happen? Because this man was in hideout. He was praying and worshiping with God. And he came out from there because God said, arise. Arise means, you know what? Sitting down, all of a sudden, arise. Waking up. You're sleeping in the slumber. God wakes you up and says, arise. In the church, sometimes I feel like God saying to some people, arise, my son, when you're sleeping in the church. In the church, when you're snoring, arise. Arise. You know what I'm saying? My point is, when you look at this, it is not about the bin of flour shall not be used up. It's not about that. It's about the word from God. That word. In Malayalam, there is a song. I'm not going to sing, but I'll still say, Yeshuve oru vakumadi. Oh God, only one word is enough for me. I need that one word from you, God. I just need that one word from you to do that. I know I can do it. And that one word from God made me come to Canada. And that one word from God made me sustain and remain in this Canada without any problem. Why? Because it's that word that is sustaining in my life. It is not my word. It's not my anything. It's all by God's grace. Hallelujah. When I do anything, people think I'm boasting, but I boast in the crucified Christ, because he is my strength, he is my fortress, he is the Lord in whom I trust, and why not I boast about him? So here is it. It's all about the word from the Lord.
Elijah got the word. Now, let's go to the next one. Elijah got the word. He got the word in chapter 17. Now, look at this again. In 18th chapter. Next, first one was, what was the first one? Get away. Second one, arise. Next one is what? Go. You know one thing? Why did God say go? Why did he say, the go present yourself to Ahab? Why did God not say to him in the chapter 17? Why did he not say? He said, except at my word, there shall be no rain. God was preparing Elijah in the chapter 17. He was growing into a faith level. And then comes a position where he hears, go present yourself to Ahab and I will send rain on the earth. Do you know something? The Bible says in the next verse, there was famine. There was famine. God says in the famine, during the famine, there will not be rain. What did he do? The word, the giant, the situation, the circumstance of your life is, I cannot believe what I'm going through. I don't think there is a solution in my famine. How can I find the solution? How can I see the solution? But instead, if you start believing in what God can do, you'll start seeing the solution. Amen. Amen. Are you getting? The thing is here, go present yourself to Ahab and I will send rain on the earth. The Bible says, what, you know, Elijah went, verse 2. Did it take time? Verse 2. No. Elijah went to present himself to Ahab. When you get the word, don't take time praying, fasting, asking everyone, do you know what God told me? All these things. No. You need to make sure it's the word from the Lord. You're walking in accordance with God's word. God's commandment. Is it too tough to understand? Here is Obadiah telling him, listen, King Ahab is trying to kill you. He has sent many of us to find where you are and we have not been able to find you. So you will be killed. Don't go to Ahab. And here is Elijah, after he heard from that Obadiah, what is he telling him? But Elijah said in verse 15, I swear by the Lord Almighty, in whose presence I stand, that I will present myself to Ahab this very day. Can you confidently say that? I will present to Ahab this very day. I will not take time to go to Ahab, but I am going to Ahab right now. Why? Not by my strength, but by whom? But by his spirit. Amen. It makes a lot of difference. So my question to you is, when you face your giant, prayer is important. Perception is important in your prayer. But equally important is your action after that. The pattern after prayer. How you go with the action. And you cannot act upon unless he tells you what to do and how to do. Amen. The method is given by him. The process is given by him. The pattern is given by him. And we must get the pattern to find the solution. When you look at the story of David, we know the story that David fought with Goliath. We know the story. In chapter 17, right? David was fighting with Goliath. But how do you think David was able to fight with Goliath? Yeah, how did he fight with this Goliath? How did he rise up to that faith? Do you know something? In the chapter 16, in chapter 15, King Saul committed sin. And here is a king who is a shadow. He has lost his anointing. And David comes into the picture. He was anointed as the king, right? He was anointed. And in this chapter 16,
Bible says in verse 14, but the spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and a distressing spirit from the Lord troubled him. And Saul's servant said to him, surely a distressing spirit from God is troubling you. Let our master now command your servants who are before you to seek out a man who is a skillful player on the harp. And it shall be that he will play it with his hand when the distressing spirit from God is upon you, and you shall be well. So Saul said to his servants, provide me now a man who can play well and bring him to me. Here is the story. King Saul is calling somebody to come to the palace because he is possessed with the evil spirit, right? Now, David, someone found David as an anointed person and he can play music, right? But look at the verse 23. And so it was, whenever, can we say whenever? Whenever the spirit from God was upon Saul, that David would take a harp and play it with his hand, then Saul would become refreshed and well, and the distressing spirit would depart from him. Are you able to get something? David of that 1 Samuel chapter 16 is a man who is anointed, who was in that anointing, able to see the distressing spirit, and with his music he was able to see the other person being delivered from the evil spirit. It is not whenever. That means it is an occasion. No, it is an often thing. It's a continuous process. Whenever this man is possessed, he will say, hey, David, David, come. David, sing. And then worship, and suddenly gone. And then again, after a few days, again Saul has a problem. David, come. David comes, play the harp, and again the evil spirit go. What I'm trying to say is, this man was getting habituated in that process of delivering the demons. Are you getting, seeing the distressing spirit? Do you know some people can see the demons? My point is, when that man was in that relationship with God, do you know, they, as I mentioned, that Elijah was coming in that position to meet Ahab and everything. He was getting into the presence of God, into the prayer life, into the worshiping mode, everything. And that Elijah could talk anything. The same way, he is a King Saul who, whenever he has got a distressing spirit, he calls David. Hey, David, come. And David could see that man is delivered. Amen? So here is a man with that kind of an habit. He comes into the chapter 17, and all the other brothers were not able to see what David saw, because they have not got that spirit in them. He's saying, the spirit of the Lord is within my heart. I will sing as David sang. I will dance as David danced. The point is that David comes in the chapter 17, and when he comes, his brothers could not identify. Rest of the army who were there in the Israel, who were facing the Philistine, the giant, rest of the brothers, everybody, rest of the people, they all thought this Goliath is too big. But David thought something. Do you know what David thought? He said, he's too big to miss. He's too big to miss. I want to get this pillow. I want to get this pillow. I want to win this match. Are you getting? Because he has that, you know, anointing inside him to see that this giant has got nothing in him to win against me. He's too big to miss. Someone said he's too big for us to fight. It all depends upon how you look at it. Because if you're in the anointing, you will see he's too big to miss. It all depends upon your relationship with God. That's what I want to tell you. If you have the habit of praying, if you have the habit of connecting with God every moment. Today night, the war is declared. Do you think the military will appoint the soldiers on that day? I'm praying that will never happen. Because the country will be finished. If they appoint me, I don't know how to use the gun. My point is, a soldier is trained for the battle even when the battle is not there. Christians are that soldier who is in the battlefield. We don't know when, where the army will come against us. If we have the habit of fighting against this giant, and that is only, you know, many times we come to the church and pray in tongues and try to do these things and try to play the drums so fast and, you know, sing so loudly and dance so much because we think anointing comes in the church. My friends, anointing comes not in the church. Before you come to the church, prepare your anointing. Shopping, all these things, remove shopping. Go to the all activities, leave all activities when you come to church. If you're leading in worship, someone like Ezekiel Francis once mentioned, I don't want anybody in my church to come and lead in worship if they're not praying in tongues for 1 hour. And he was telling, I can see the anointing. Leave aside everything. When you come to church, leave aside everything. All the other activities. Sunday is a day when you are giving it to the Lord. Worship Him in spirit and in truth. When you start doing it as a unit, we will be anointed so much that we will see all the giants around us will start going away. Because we develop the habit inside us to fight, to win. Are you getting? Don't try to take the gun that time when the enemy comes. Make sure the gun works. Make sure the gun works. And that working gun only can win a battle. And that is, your gun is not that gun what others are using. Your gun is the full armor of God. Amen. Belt of truth buckled around your waist. Tell not what you believe, tell what God says about you. Amen. This is what my God says, and I will believe in what my God says. Start believing in what God says, and then move. The word of the Lord came to Elijah. Can we all believe that word of the Lord came to me? If you think you have a problem in your family, pray with God. He will talk. You have a problem with job? On 29th December, my company was harassing me a lot. That night I came and prayed at home. That night the Lord told me I have broken something. Within 2 days, I got an interview call from nowhere. I got a job. From that, God did a miracle. My God is so big. Amen. So, what I want to tell you is, today, we need to know, prayer has to be followed with the pattern. And pattern, not our pattern. It should be God's pattern. When we move into God's pattern, we are walking on the word of God. Right? You know that song, lyrics of the song? Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Then next stanza, whenever I am afraid, when I am afraid, you're there right now. Nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near to the end. Isn't it? Hallelujah. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet, and I know that you will lead me. Amen. You're right beside me. And what faith you have and understanding you have in that will make you move things around you. Whether you have anybody around you, you will say, my God has brought me here. I will remain. Hallelujah. I will remain in Canada. I will see my God establish my ways. And I will not run from any of the things. I will establish in this country because it's at His word I came. Amen. It's at His word I came. Hallelujah. Can we pray?